Welcome. So I'd like to start with a land acknowledgement. Iowa State University aspires to be the best land-grant university at creating a welcoming and inclusive environment where diverse individuals can succeed and thrive. As a land-grant institution, we are committed to the caretaking of this land and would like to begin this event by acknowledging those who have previously taken care of the land on which we gather. Before the site became Iowa State University, it was the ancestral lands and territory of the Bakote or Iowa Nation. The United States obtained land from the Meskwaki and Sauk Nations in the Treaty of 1842. We wish to recognize our obligations to this land and to the people who took care of it, as well as to 17,000 Native people who live in Iowa today. November is Indigenous Heritage Month. Please check out the library's Indigenous Heritage Month online exhibit created by Katie Wampel and Susan Vega Garcia of the library's Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Committee. This was shared out on the library's social media pages last week. You can find an announcement on Facebook or Twitter. I'm sure you could probably Google it too. This course was inspired by a class called Researching History that had been taught by Katrina Jackson, our former head, back when she was head of instruction and outreach at the Special Collections Library at the University of Virginia. Last year, I co-instructed with two of my colleagues, Amy Bishop and Rachel Atchison, and the final projects were group presentations of many exhibits. Some of you may have seen that, seen it last year. This year, we had to do things a bit differently. We became a hybrid course, but the mission of this course remained the same. I did not co-teach this time, but had many guest instructors that I'm grateful for. Brendan Dunphy, who is a researcher, ISC alum, and filmmaker, and my colleagues, Greg Bailey, Amy Bishop, and Rachel Atchison. The purpose of this course is to demystify primary source research and develop primary source research skills for undergraduate students. The goal is for these students to understand the past and recognize historical narratives as constructed, to be able to inform and educate others about the value of archives and cultural heritage institutions as information resources, not as vaults stored with hidden treasures. We want the students to understand the stories that primary sources reveal about people, society, and events. For their final project, students had to select three items they encountered in the course for their research this semester and do a research or some kind of creative presentation of those primary sources. So there's a nice mix of that today. As I mentioned before, we're recording this presentation and it will be available in the ISU digital repository. We're going to go in alphabetical order. I'm file sharing, so there'll probably be a little bit of transition. I'm going to let the students introduce themselves. Rachel Brokenshire is our first student. So go ahead and introduce yourself, Rachel, and then I'll start your presentation.
Okay, hello everyone. I'm Rachel Brokenshire and I'm a freshman at Iowa State University and I am at the College of Design. And one of the first things we do in the College of Design for the core design is we went around and we got to sketch sculptures. And I realized that we have a lot of sculptures at Iowa State and a lot of them were by Christian Peterson. And so I did a little presentation on just what I learned about Christian Peterson through the archives. And actually there's a lot of information on Christian Peterson. There's a museum even too, but I think what the archives showed me was really another layer of him, like a more personal and just like his character and just how much he contributed and why he's a legend and why he still is such a big name at Iowa State. And so I hope that my video inspires you to do some more research. I couldn't condense everything into a little 5 minutes, but I hope that it kind of opens your eyes to the stories behind all the art here on campus. And yeah, I hope you enjoy.
As a design student at Iowa State University, which is home to one of the largest campus public art programs in the US. One of my first assignments in my drawing class included sketching sculptures around our beautiful campus. It didn't take long for me though to notice that the majority of the sculptures I was intensely studying and drawing were created by a man by the name of Christian Peterson. I have been able to pursue my interest in learning who this Christian Peterson is in my archives investigation class, and I've had no trouble at all finding a plethora of resources and information on his fascinating and influential life. I'm not even going to attempt to fit all the intriguing stories I've learned regarding Christian Peterson and his creations as an artist and impact as an Iowa State professor. Instead, I will be sharing excerpts of an article on Christian Peterson that I believe captures the person he was and the legacy he has left. I hope this presentation opens your eyes to how Christian Peterson has left his mark on Iowa State's campus and inspires you to dig into the story of his life and the meaning behind the sculptures on campus that most people pass by without a second thought, because each has a story and a message of its own if one only takes a little bit of time to look. Now I'll be reading the first and last paragraph from an article I found in the Iowa State University archives under the Christian Peterson Papers Collection. The article is by Ray Murray and is entitled Campus Culturist. On the North Campus of Iowa State College at Ames, works in quiet yet becoming and majestic humility, one who has achieved many of the alluring art awards his America offers. For Danish-born Christian Peterson knows the urge to create, feels the need of giving life to dead clay or lifeless stone, and holds in his flexible fingers and hardy hands the ability to mold his longings into realities. Here, his mastery of the mysteries of the casting and carving cults has merited the appreciation and applause of other artists everywhere. It is most unusual for an agricultural college to have a sculptor as a teacher, but Christian Peterson has proved the worthiness of his selection. Important as he may be as an artist, he is equally understanding and able as a faculty member. The gifts he has given to Iowans has been, in turn, compensated by Iowa in the gifts it has given him. For here was he made great. Christian Peterson is as much Iowa as his corn.
Thank you, Rachel, for your presentation. I'm getting a sound lag, or it sounds like a sound issue. So I'm gonna encourage the students to also submit their projects to the digital repository so you can see them in their entirety there also. Thank you, Rachel. Next is Ada Ellingworth. She is doing a live presentation. I'm gonna share my screen and she should be able to pop on. And we'll get through this. So Ada, let me see. Let me make sure I can find the controls for advancing. Okay, I have the controls. I'm ready when you're ready. Just say next when you want me to advance.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Ada Ellingworth. I am a sophomore in the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences. And for my presentation, I looked in the archives for maps of Iowa and related these maps of Iowa to our home here in Ames through poetry. So this is my presentation. As the land speaks, seeing time through cartography. Next. So this map pictured here is from the Library of Congress. It is a map of the Iowa Railroad Land Company from around 1871. On the top, you can see that there is a map of Iowa and Illinois and parts of Nebraska. And in Iowa, you can see these parts that are dark gray. And these are sections of land that were actually being sold by the railroad. In the bottom, you can see that there's a description of different characteristics of the land, from what the soil is like, the weather, to what the produce is there and the prices of the land. And so I use these descriptions from this map to craft a poem talking about Ames and the land that was sold by the railroads. Next. As the land speaks. Here at home, we watch and wait as the world about us turns. But for a moment, lean in your ears listen to the land and learn. Turn time to centuries past when the sac and fox roamed free. With care and patience, they tended the land until they were ordered to leave. For many years, this rich black loam was home to prairies big and bold. But in these years, 200 passed, far from these hills has it rolled. Those years brought binds of timber and steel cut across this land like scars. Coast to coast, the rails were laid as settlers came from near and far. Seek this new world, the song rang out, of rich land and woods turned gold. Prairie and pasture and forest to burn bright, neath summer's heat and winter's dark cold. Reap the land's fertile reward with bushels of barley and oats. Or furnish free pasturage for miles about, here graze cattle, sheep, and goats. Yet this land between the rivers holds more than pasture and field. For deep down below, in rock and in stone, black veins of coal bear great yield. All this and more the land offers here for you to come and take. Come one, come all, O settlers of land, come here and riches you shall make. For with this ticket, an easy toll, a land exploration comes quick. See the land with purchase intent, and soon you shall have your pick. Towns grow large as time ticks on, and acres from hand to hand roam. Life sprouts among the lost prairie grass, and even now calls you home. Turn back to today in this Iowa town and think of what might have been. Had not the railroads cut through the land and been charted by hand and pen. Next. As I was writing this poem, I wanted to focus in on the different, how the maps and archives I was looking at shaped the poem in the different stanzas. The first stanza was shaped by this map of the city of Ames that I found in the Iowa State University Library Special Collection and University Archives from the papers of Charles S. Gwynn. On this map, you can see in the bottom right, there is a large line that is cutting through downtown Ames. And then as you go towards the left, it's actually going over the Iowa State College campus. This map is undated, but it does show the Iowa Railroad as it's cutting through Ames. Next. My second stanza, as you may have heard, focused on the Sac and Fox who once lived in Iowa. And we can see it here on this map image from Library of Congress. This picture is zoomed in from a hydrographical basin map of the Upper Mississippi River, and it's focused specifically here on Iowa. So you can see the area where Ames is currently was actually once owned by the Sac and Fox tribes of the Meskwaki Native Americans. And so while I was writing the poem, I wanted to pay respect to them. And so this is what the stanza focused on. Next. Then for the next few stanzas, I focus on the different descriptors in the advertisement. So first, it talks a lot about the railroads, and this kind of leads back to the Western expansion as everything, all the railroads were stretching back towards California. So here I focus specifically on kind of the surface and soil and the railroads, because those were some of the major selling points. Next. Then next, the map also focuses on a lot of the agricultural and livestock produce of Iowa. So it mentions all the agricultural aspects, such as corn and wheat, barley and potatoes, as well as fruit, stock raising, timber, and coal. Next. And then finally, it also talks about maps as advertisements. This map and this entire document was meant as an advertisement to get people to come out west to Iowa. And so here you can see some more of the natural resources by its advertising, as well as how Iowa's been growing, reasons to buy, and then also the prices. Next. And then finally, the last really interesting thing I found about this was the land exploration ticket. So this was a purchase incentive that was meant to, once you bought a land exploration ticket, you could use it to travel to any of the areas that the railroad was selling land, you could look at the land, and then you could buy the land also. And then when you bought it, the price of your ticket actually went towards that. So you weren't losing any money by you buying a land expiration ticket. And I found this really interesting. It was a very unique incentive. Next. And finally, this is an image zoomed in particularly right in the area where Ames is. So Ames is along the solid black line cutting through the image. And I just want us to think for a moment. What would have happened to Ames if there was not a railroad cutting through? Would it still be here, or would Ames maybe never have been founded? And what would that mean for Iowa State? Thank you.
Thank you, Eva. First question. Okay.
And you've got a caption link, Rachel.
Excellent. I shared the caption link in the chat about 3:41, but I can post it in again.
If they got it, if you sent it once, it's probably there, I would imagine.
Okay. I sent it. You're welcome. Thank you, Karen, for making it.
You bet.
Okay, so next we have Luella Gask.
Hi, everyone. My name is Luella Gaskell. I am a junior, double majoring in supply chain management and finance, and my presentation is titled ISU YAF, Present Members on the Past. In the course of learning about the archives and looking for a presentation topic, I was excited to come across some articles about a club that I've belonged to for over a year now. The club is Young Americans for Freedom, or YAF, and it is a conservative club here on campus. This current chapter was only created in the last couple years, so I was very surprised to find Iowa State Daily articles about the club that were dated in the 70s and the 90s. The two articles I will be sharing with you all today talk about the club's purpose on campus, as well as some of the current issues and projects they were involved in at the time. The first article I will be sharing today has a title that's a bit of an oxymoron. The article was published February 18, 1991, written by Jennifer Wilson, and it is titled Hardcore Conservatives Form Campus YAF. The article goes into the purpose of the club itself and some of the club's involvement, including support of the Persian Gulf War and a legal case against race-based scholarships. It lists some of the YAF activities, including fundraisers, distributing literature such as the group's official magazine, New Guard, attending rallies, and even sending members to DC for a national convention. I also shared these articles with some current members and was able to include some of their comments. This is a quote from the ISU YAF president in 1991, Greg Fetterman, and our current club president, Chuck Klapotowskis' thoughts on it. We are a conservative organization. Basically, what we do is say what the college Republicans or Republican groups can't say because of political ties. We're not constrained by party politics. I think that statement is so interesting because it was one of the focal reasons we restarted the YAF chapter 2 years ago. We were frustrated by the conservative voices on campus and wanted to create a group that didn't limit what our club members could advocate for or speak on. I think our club embodies those values today, and it is refreshing to see that those have been held throughout history. The next article I will share today is titled YAF Dedicated to Maintaining Rights of Each Individual. It was published on May 7, 1973 and was written by D. Ann Wienschoten. This article also talks about the purpose of the club itself, as well as some of the reasons that members chose to join the club, such as the opportunity to meet prominent political figures such as Vice President Spiro Agnew and discuss topics with people who, quote, simply want the conservative point of view. The article also discusses some of the projects they were involved in at the time, such as striking against amnesty, selling bracelets in support of prisoners of war in Vietnam, and working to abolish mandatory student fees. Their efforts regarding student fees was the topic of my next quote from Chuck. It is so refreshing to hear that YAF has been invested in this in the past, because it shows YAF has, and continues to be, the voice for conservative students on campus. As we currently look to cut down on fees that seem to constantly rise and punish students, it is frightening to see that this has been a constant battle. One thing that stood out to me was that both of these articles mentioned the Sharon Statement. I found the statement on the University of California Calisphere Digital Archives. I had never heard of the Sharon Statement before, and found out that it was the founding statement of principles for the Young Americans for Freedom organization, written in 1960 and named after the town it was written in, Sharon, Connecticut. I thought that this quote from 1973 ISU YAF chairperson Becky Borgstrand summed it up well. Basically, the Sharon Statement supports the U.S. Constitution, reserves the powers of states' rights, seeks to preserve U.S. sovereignty and international order, and provides for a strong national defense. There was a similar description of the Sharon Statement in the 1991 article, as well as this comment from the YAF National Vice Chairman, Eric Allen Koch. Though these words were written almost 30 years ago, the West is in no less a time of moral, political, cultural, and spiritual crisis. Those 30 years he mentions are 60 years now, and it feels even more relevant today. It makes me wonder about how we view the past and how different we think it is from now. These articles have shown me that even though a lot has changed in the 60 years since the Sharon Statement was written, there is so much that has stayed the same. To end my presentation today, I would like to share a quote from Laura Emery, the current ISU YAF Vice President. "I believe the purpose of YAF is to advance conservative ideas on college campuses. Whether advances take place because one conservative student no longer feels alone on campus, or a group of conservatives rallying together to make a change, they're serving the purpose of YAF. YAF has grown substantially in the past 2 years on campus. One highlight was when we brought Andrew Clavin to campus to give a lecture. His lecture drew hundreds of people, some of whom may have never considered a conservative option before. Advancing conservatism, or any cause, is not easy, but it truly is worth it. Thank you."
Hello, my name is Emily Galing. I'm currently a junior here at Iowa State, and I'm majoring in history and anthropology. My presentation is on Thomas Clifton, or T.C. McCall, who was a prominent community leader and Civil War veteran. I chose this topic because I love learning about history. The Civil War is a topic that I haven't had the chance to extensively dive into yet at college, so this project allowed me to research a topic that I may not be able to take a class on. T.C. McCall was born on September 4th, 1827 in Ross County, Ohio. He eventually moved to Nevada, Iowa in 1858, where he lived until his death in 1892. Throughout his life, T.C. McCall was married three times. He had one son, John Austin McCall, with his first wife. After the death of his first wife, McCall went on to marry Mary A. Boynton, with whom he had three children, Minnie, Fred, and Edward. Following Mary's death, McCall married Clara Kennedy. Together, they had one son who unfortunately died at the age of five. Throughout his time in Nevada, McCall ran a successful real estate business and went on to represent the Republican Party in the Senate. During the Civil War, T.C. McCall served in the 32nd Regiment of the Iowa Infantry. He was appointed to the position of quartermaster in September of 1862 and served as quartermaster until his discharge in 1864. Despite fighting in the Civil War, McCall still participated in his real estate business. He still oversaw various operations like tax payments, though much of his work was done through or by his wife, Mary. In addition to maintaining his business, McCall was also in semi-regular contact with his wife and son, John Austin. The majority of the letters he received from John lamented his absence and his inability to continually write letters to his son. His absence was felt especially during Christmas, when John wrote to his father wishing he was home. On the left is a map of the Red River Campaign in Arkansas and Louisiana. The 32nd Regiment participated in this campaign, which lasted from March 10th to May 22nd in 1864. Over the course of my research, the thing that initially drew me to T.C. McCall was his ancestry. While looking for a topic, I stumbled upon T.C. McCall and found out that he comes from a long line of military veterans who have served in some of the most famous wars in American history. His father, Samuel W. McCall, fought in the War of 1812 and subsequently suffered an injury to his arm during the conflict. His grandfather, Samuel McCall, served in the American Army during the Revolutionary War. His other grandfather, on his mother's side, Thomas Clifton, also was a member of the American Army and served under General Greene for 7 years, participating in conflicts like the Battle of Cowpens. These are my sources, including boxes from the McCall Family Papers Collection and Special Collections. My other sources include a map, which I found in the Library of Congress's digital collections, and an article about the 32nd Regiment from the National Park Service's website.
Hello, everyone. My name is Zachary Hotman, and my Archives Honors Project will be discussing the time the 19th Iowa Infantry Regiment were prisoners of war during the American Civil War. And we're going to look at that through the perspective of a man named William Bragg. I don't have enough time to go through all 50 pages worth of content, so I'll give some highlights from what Bragg experienced. The reason I chose this is because when most people hear the term POW, they usually think of World War II, for good reason. And I wanted to look at a different era of POWs and see how they compared. I also talk about the process that I went through briefly. So we'll get some general information out of the way. The 19th Regiment was, or were, imprisoned for roughly 10 months, and then they were exchanged with the Union. They spent most of their time at Camp Tyler, and that is in the eastern part of Texas. They were captured in Louisiana, and I thought it was interesting. They were sent out to bait a Confederate general, and unfortunately, he took the bait, and he also brought 5,000 men with him. Something that's rather remarkable is that the 19th Regiment and the other Union regiments that were with them managed to hold them off for roughly 2 hours, but obviously they were captured at some point, and they were taken about 300 miles to Camp Ford. So one main thing I wanted to get across were the interactions between Union and Confederate soldiers, and I'll just give a couple examples. I was advised to do this. So, the first one is why I have this. This happened when they were first handed off to a man named Captain Alford, and he would often make the prisoners run for over 20 miles, and anyone that was lagging behind or tried to take a break, he would grab a lasso and he would tie it around their neck, and basically he would drag them for several miles. So now we don't need that anymore. The other one, this one's more positive. This was near the end of their imprisonment, and they met these Confederate soldiers who were very nice to them. And it turns out that was because they had been at the siege of Vicksburg, and the 19th Iowa had actually given them food, and so they were basically repaying them for that. One thing Bragg talked about was Yankee ingenuity, or what he called Yankee ingenuity. And it was basically, I'm just going to give a couple examples. They mainly showed up as escape attempts. Two men from the regiment hid in these carts that basically took filth out of the prison camps. So basically, these two soldiers escaped through 18th century dump trucks, and another guy played dead, and he was buried in a shallow grave, and then he escaped through there. So I just wanted to bring those two up. This guy is Dungan, James Dungan. He has a whole thing in the archives, but I can't talk about him. I only brought him because I wanted to show the condition the clothes were in most of the time, because they were exposed to the elements for months on end, so their clothes were usually torn quite a bit. And these are from the Digital Library of America, I believe, and they are basically the enlistment and dischargement sort of little slips that a soldier was given. And that one is William Bragg, that's his private sergeant, and that one's Dungan, and that's his corporal and sergeant. So I appreciate you taking the time to listen to this, and that's just for Rachel. So I hope you have a good day, and that's all.
Hello, I'm Audrey Jenkins. I'm a junior in agronomy, and I'm also minoring in bio and pre-med illustration. My project is on the process of an artist, Frank C. Murphy. Murphy was an incredible artist that spent most of his career working in agricultural advertising. Frank C. Murphy has always been intrigued by farm life. He went to Iowa State, majoring in econ and journalism, but spent all the time he could at farms and ranches. After graduating, Murphy moved to Chicago, where he took illustration courses. His first job as an artist for an advertising agency was at Quaker Oats for their Full of Pep feeds in the late 1940s. Later on in his career, he worked for the American Angus Association to promote the Angus breed in the U.S. The painting on the left of a calf watching a butterfly is his most famous painting. These black cows were hard to photograph with the technology of the time, and they often came out flat. Murphy, on the other hand, could capture them perfectly, showing their shape and texture. About this, he said, "Photography was not yet up to the job, and so it was the illustrator who could create the fantasy." Like Murphy noted, most of the advertising of the time was done through illustration instead of photographs. This is an advertisement put out by the Dow Chemical Company in 1951. Through this ad, they wanted to emphasize the abundance of the land, and the best way to do so was with an illustration. This ad and information comes from the online archives of the Science History Institute. These are some examples of sketches he did as process work. You can notice small arrows on the calf on the left, where the clients wanted changes in its posture. And these are examples of some of his finalized paintings. They've already been through rounds of revision as sketches, where editors and the clients could request changes. The most interesting thing I found in Frank C. Murphy's archive box was finalized art and process work for a brochure. It was created for Purina Mills to show information on gestation and lactation in pigs. For my project, I created GIFs that show the transition from sketches to finalized works. I'll show them as I continue to speak about his artistic process. Work was mainly done on illustration board, pencil first and then paint. The pencil they used was usually charcoal to create a continuous tone. They often use gouache as the paint, which is similar to an opaque watercolor. For this particular project, he used charcoal pencil on vellum overlays for the sketches, and watercolor or gouache for the final illustrations. He also noted that he did research for this project from textbooks. On why they worked in this way, he says, "The main reason for all this was speed. Although most art deadlines were not unreasonable, they would generally be very short, with little allowance for client changes, false starts, or accidents. Weekend and all-night sessions did happen." He also noted, "In all of my animal art, I have instinctively put expression into the eyes. It was especially effective in making a personal connection with the reader. I hope this provides some insight into the process of an artist. especially one as great as Frank C. Murphy. These are the sources I used for my project, including multiple folders from the Frank C. Murphy Papers box, the Dow ad from the Digital Public Library of America, and an article on Murphy published in the Angus Journal in the 90s.
Hello, everyone. My name is Nathan Matthews, and I'm a senior double majoring in Accounting and International Business. My research project is titled The Trials and Tribulations of John David Provost. Throughout this presentation, I will recount some of John David Provost's life during World War II and the ensuing trials. I chose this topic because I am fascinated with history and the criminal justice system. Once I learned about this case from the university archives, I was intrigued about the cases involved and was able to learn more about primary sources while using physical repositories and digital collections. John David Provost was fluent in Japanese, was a devout Buddhist, and even spent some time in a Buddhist monastery near Tokyo, Japan in 1940. Following his time in Japan, he returned to America and enlisted in the United States Army in 1941, where he was sent to the Philippines. In 1942, he fought in the Battle of Corregidor and was subsequently captured by Japanese soldiers and became a prisoner of war, more commonly known as a POW. In 1945, he was liberated, but that was not the end of his hardships. Once he was back in the United States, he was arrested and charged with treason due to various overt acts as a POW. For example, he was alleged to have caused the death of a U.S. captain, tried to convince a U.S. colonel to turn over U.S. codes, and supposedly beat up a U.S. sergeant to get information about $750 million in silver that was dumped into Manila Bay. Interestingly, the U.S. captain that died due to Mr. Provost's actions was named Burton Campbell Thompson, nicknamed Stretch, and he was an Iowa State alumnus. It is important to note that a conviction of wartime treason carried the possibility of the death penalty. After 8 months of deliberation and investigation, the court found no proof that he had collaborated with Japanese forces and was honorably discharged. Fascinatingly, 6 weeks after the trial concluded, he re-enlisted in the military. This time, he only lasted 3 years before he was indicted with 7 counts of treason. The trial had over 90 witnesses, including General Jonathan Wainwright, the U.S. commander at Corregidor, although the prosecution only called 15 witnesses to the stand, one of which is pictured on the right and is demonstrating a deep bow that Mr. Provost would allegedly make when the Japanese soldiers arrived. In 1953, Mr. Provost was found guilty of 4 acts of treason, including the death of an American officer, and was sentenced to life imprisonment. However, the court reversed the treason conviction because of 3 reasons. Firstly, the court ruled that the trial had been brought in the wrong federal county district. Secondly, there was irrelevant testimony regarding Mr. Provost's sexuality, which had prejudiced the jury. Lastly, he had spent 5.5 years waiting for a verdict, which meant he was denied his constitutional right to a speedy trial. In addition, this trial was estimated to have cost the government $1 million. Overall, during the whole trial, Mr. Provost claimed his innocence and that he had only offered his services as an interpreter due to his fluency in Japanese and had only helped, not harmed, his fellow prisoners. While this was the end of Mr. Provost's treason trials, this was not his last time in a courtroom. In 1957, he was charged with contributing to the delinquency of a minor due to his accompanying and encouragement of a 16-year-old boy who was running away from home. Eventually, he was sentenced to 3 years in the Nebraska Reformatory on a morals charge. All in all, regardless of whether he actively committed treason or not, his life was not the same. And here are my sources. Thank you.
I'm Galen Palmer, presenting on Edwardian women's fashion.
The Edwardian period is named for King Edward VII, who ascended to England's throne after Queen Victoria's death in 1901. This time period is generally confused with the Victorian period, which was characterized by ball gown dresses, as seen by the picture, and the Queen's own fashion over her 64 years as Queen. Following in his mother's footsteps, Edward influenced the fashion of the elite. The confusion surrounding the Edwardian and Victorian time periods is due to the closeness in which they occurred, the large time period of Victoria's reign, and the thus extensive change in fashion, and some subtle differences in the silhouette of dresses that happened at the end of the Queen's time. The end of this time period was due both to Edward's death in 1910 and the start of the First World War in 1914. Shifting into the dress of the time period, elite women's fashion was notable for many trends, including how many layers they could wear. The layer that was directly in contact with skin was a chemise, longer than the ones today, and drawers, similar to above-knee baggy shorts, all with lace ruffles, as well as stockings as illustrated, which could include designs that are fairly similar to today's. Just over the chemise was the corset at the time, which emphasized an S-bend in the back and allowed there to be a similar effect as a bustle or extra fabric at the back of the dress. These corsets were worn at the bust and included straps to attach over the drawers to the stockings. Wearing them over the chemise was to protect the corset from the skin's oils, as well as to protect the skin from the boning, which allowed them to be tightened. Corsets were not worn to be as tight as possible, but had a similar purpose to that of the brassiere. Next came corset covers and petticoats. These too included lots of lace and ruffles. Corset covers could be attached to petticoats or alone, as it wasn't uncommon to wear multiple petticoats, which is the full-length skirt that went under the final layer of dress. These typically were either white or black. Along with corset covers, detached collars would be worn to cover a lady from head to foot. The final layer of the dress required to be decent was the outer layer, the actual dress. For day dresses, they were floor length and went up to the neck, while sleeves could be elbow length in the summer. Some dresses were split, allowing the top, waist, and bottom skirt to be mixed. These could be elaborate or simplistic, but they had to match their hats in color and design. Non-form-fitting trench coats and the like were the style, allowing them to cover all the layers various outfits may have. These coats came most commonly in darker colors, such as black, gray, or tan, like mine. For vibrant colors, red would be an outlier, while dark blue would be more common. Fur was extremely common in the winter, being as warm as it was. Scarves, coats, capes, muffs, collars, and hats could all be worn or lined with fur, with the head, feet, and tail of the animal included for some items, as seen by my scarf. Fur types were wolf, fox, seal, mink, as well as a variety of other animals, many of which are still preferred today. I conclude with the most important characteristic of the Edwardian age, hats. These boisterous accessories would commonly include ostrich feathers, as seen by the vast majority of the hats in these pictures, as well as a variety of other bird feathers or even taxidermied birds. Veils, such as the one I am wearing, were also in fashion during the time. Near the beginning of the era, these hats were smaller and grew as the time period progressed. Winter millinery would have fur caps, which too would have feathers or other such accessories. Here are my sources. My knowledge all comes from the Mary A. Barton collection, as well as personal interest and knowledge I picked up over the years.
It'll be just a minute loading up Aiden's file. If anyone has any questions while we're waiting this to load, you can enter them in chat or Q&A, but maybe chat would be easier to see. And I can have the students answer them. Apologies, I thought I got it loaded earlier, but I did not. Okay. So here's that, I mean, the panel, you all can see this, students, but a question from Olivia Garrison. Did any of you find anything really neat in the archives that you're not able to include in your presentation? Please unmute yourselves and answer. And if there aren't any volunteers, I might pick some. Dylan, I know that you came in extra time to do some research. Was there anything, you had a ton and always had boxes on hold. Was there anything that you didn't include in the presentation just to cut it short or didn't fit or?
I mean, there was quite a bit that I had to cut down. It's kind of funny because the reason why I started the project, like I didn't even touch on that. It was specifically about the brooches, which I found a little bit on, but not enough to make a presentation. So, yeah.
What about you, Ada?
For me, yeah, there actually were a few things. One thing I found also in the Charles S. Gwynn collection in SCUA was actually a book of Iowa maps from around the 1920s to 1940s. And so each page in the book was one of the Iowa counties. So I really wanted to incorporate the Story County map. I just wasn't able to incorporate it. And I found it really interesting because Gwynn actually made a number of notes on it. I thought it was pretty cool.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Hello, my name is Aiden Peterson. I'm a freshman in computer engineering, and I decided to do my research on John Atanasoff. Obviously, I love computers. Thought it would be a cool thing to research John Atanasoff, as he was the creator of the first electrical computer at Iowa State University. Okay, so before I get into all of Atanasoff's work and cool things about him, I'd like to talk about my experience with the archives. I had a great time. It was super cool. I got to research a bunch of documents, especially this amazing one on screen right here. Interesting. But you had a great time. There are so many documents I couldn't find anywhere else. It was awesome. Okay, so before John Atanasoff made his Atanasoff Berry computer, he worked as a researcher at Iowa State University. So he actually modified a IBM tabulator machine so that he could do specific calculations with it. I thought this was really interesting. I found this information from a outline by this guy named Mollenhoff, who was a Des Moines Register columnist. And he really liked writing about Atanasoff and all of his work. And he wrote a biography about him that was a pretty big deal, I think. He was a Pulitzer Prize winner. So I found this information in an outline, and then later in the outline it said that he wrote a paper, but he couldn't find the paper. in the outline, like he said, he couldn't find the paper. So I just like looked up the paper, found it on the archives website. It was pretty cool. Okay, so now onto Atanasoff's computer. So he made the first electrical computer, meaning that it used binary or meaning it used electrical logic instead of mechanical logic like the IBM tabulator that he was using before. It meant that, it really set the foundation for the future of all of the computers to come after, as using electrical components is much simpler, and it also is quite a bit faster too. So Atanasoff actually had an assistant when he was building his computer named Clifford Berry. He was a graduate student at the time, and he just helped him out with the building of the computer. So the computer was a pretty simple, pretty kind of primitive. It was able to really solve only one kind of problem, which was systems of linear equations. It could solve up to systems of 29 linear equations, which was definitely useful at the time because it's not easy to solve systems of 29 linear equations because it just takes forever. But it was definitely built for that specific problem, and it couldn't do anything else. So one of the other big outcomes of his computer, it used binary logic instead of like base 10 or other sort of systems of holding numbers. So it used binary, base 2, ones and zeros, and then it was able to convert that into base 10, where it output onto a punch card using a cool base 2 to base 10 wheel thing they had in the machine. Okay, so one of the more interesting things I found while researching John Atanasoff was he was involved in a court case called Honeywell v. Rand, which was a court case between the company Sperry Rand and the other company, Honeywell. So Sperry Rand was suing Honeywell because they believed that they infringed on their patent to the ENIAC, which they bought from John Mockley. So in the court case, it was actually ruled that it was derived from the ABC, and Atanasoff actually got co-founder status on the patent, which is a very cool turn of event. He actually got paid pretty well by Honeywell. I got to read some cool secret documents, and it actually showed that he got paid a good chunk of change for participating with Honeywell as a consultant, which was pretty cool. Okay, so onto my sources. I used a bunch of papers from the John Vincent Atanasoff collection, which obviously has a bunch of papers about John Vincent Atanasoff. There's a bunch of cool stuff in there, from things that reporters like Mollenhof wrote about him to all of the different research and papers that he did. I only was able to go through three boxes, but there were so many, so much information that I missed out on. I also used a box from the Henry L. Hansen collection, which was about a patent clerk who worked for the corporation division, and he worked on the Honeywell v. Sperry Rand case, so I was able to get a bunch of information about that case through that one box.
And for our last presentation is Nolan. But then, Nolan, can you introduce yourself, please?
Hi, everyone. Thank you for coming out. My name is Nolan Pinan. I'm a junior studying biology, philosophy, and music. Not necessarily in that order. My project for this seminar is called The Destruction of Reims Cathedral. It's a piano piece that I was inspired to write when I learned that there was a cathedral in Reims, France, that was bombed by Germany during World War I. The song consists of three basic motives. The first was simply inspired by the beauty of the cathedral. The second, I christened the bombing of the steeples, where two towers of the cathedral were damaged. I don't recall if I used that postcard in this presentation, but as the music plays, you'll be seeing the pictures that inspired it. The third motive is the ruins of the sanctuary, which was inspired by one of the postcards I got the chance to see out of the university archives that featured a shattered light fixture in the middle of the sanctuary of the cathedral. And finally, the piece is ended by a reprise of the original cathedral motif. So without further ado, please enjoy the destruction of Reims Cathedral.
Yay! So that concludes our presentation. So we have time, a little bit of time, because we started late for Q&A. If anyone has any questions, again, you can enter in the chat or the Q&A section. I did notice, and this is for anyone, you know, maybe thinking of doing an event like this, I think the two largest files, I believe, are the ones that have the issues with sound. When I played them, of course, they were fine, but now that we're all alive and doing an event, but hopefully they'll be in the digital repository and can be heard in their entirety there. No questions. Last call. Oh, maybe. Hold on. I don't I think it's wrong. Well, so this is a question for any or all of the panelists. What was the most unexpected thing you learned this semester about archives or the process of doing archival research? Okay. Again, if no one volunteers, I'm just gonna call on someone. Give a second to volunteer. Who have we not heard from? Luella, what do you think? What was the most unexpected thing you learned this semester about archives and the process of doing archival research?
You know, I went into this class not really knowing much at all about archives. I was just really surprised by the variety of materials you could find in the archives. I thought it was really interesting learning about the different types of media that were available. Like, my presentation was mostly newspaper articles, but like, just like the variety of materials we were able to look at in class was really interesting to me.
Thanks, Luella. What about you, Rachel? Rachel?
Sorry, I'm in my dorm room and I just realized that the vacuum cleaner is going, but hopefully you can still hear me. I think just what surprised me the most is I pictured it like the movies, you know, like they're in the dark dungeon and like archives and so secretive, like in Marvel. So I have to say it was like cool to see like what archives really is about. And it was just like in the library and like super available to just like the normal person. So I was really open to what archives actually is.
Yay. A question for Aiden Peterson. From Amy Bishop, you showed a document early in your presentation and said it was cool. Could you tell us more about what that document was and why you thought it was cool?
So I think you're referring to the document that was just like gibberish on a page. I thought that was just funny, so I put that on there. I couldn't really figure out what it was for. It looked like it was for notes or something. I just thought it was funny.
Thank you, Aiden. This question, I think, we'll throw out to anyone. Hopefully someone will volunteer. What was the most challenging part of working with archives?
For me, the most challenging part was a lot of my material in the archives were letters from, like, you know, like the 19th century. So deciphering the handwriting of T.C. McCall and his, like, wives and his children was extremely difficult, and in some cases I just like could not read it in the cursive, and sometimes they were like damaged or stained, so it was just very difficult to actually discern what they were actually talking about.
Good point. Handwriting's hard to read sometimes. Question for Ada from Katie Wampole. Great project. It's awesome that you were able to link archive cartography with poetry. Oh, That's not a question. That's just a nice compliment. Thanks, Katie. Okay, another open question from Greg Bailey. Does your work with archives change your mindset on your future studies and possibly incorporating them into your schoolwork? Audrey Jenkins, what do you think?
Hi, that's a good question. Since my project was on art or illustration in agricultural advertising, I say for me, it does relate. I'm studying agronomy as well as bio and pre-med illustration. So there are things that I was already interested in and I'm planning to continue with.
Excellent. I really enjoyed, I thought your, you told me what you're doing. I was excited about everyone's presentations, but I really liked that you pointed that out and the different phases. Very good. Of illustration. Okay, let's see. Okay, so this is another one from Amy Bishop. Good job, everyone. I found all your presentations very interesting and so fun. She just commented to see all the different directions your interest took you in. That wasn't meant to be a question. It was meant to be an exclamation point. Thank you, Amy. It was fun to see them discover everything. It was fun to see the students start to get excited and learn from the concept, hear people lecture, not concrete to being like to see a real solid interest in like real actual materials. Okay, I think, let me just double check on any more questions or chats. Okay, I don't see anyone. Thank you everyone for attending and for sticking it out with us through our technical difficulties. I'll be sharing more out about, when the recording's available and maybe highlight, the different presentations if the students let me repurpose them in our blog post. So yes, thank you everyone for coming and thank you students for risking a public presentation and trusting the process and doing the work, much appreciated. Thank you everybody. Have a good rest of your day.